that the project was undertaken by the Department of Archaeology of West Bengal, which was under the state government, along with in collaboration with this department, the present department where I'm teaching nowadays. So, and I joined as a research scholar in 1992. To express, I mean, why we have undertaken this project, and I should mention the name of the project, which was that urbanization pattern of the Sultanate city of Gaur and Pandua. And unfortunately, though it was mentioned by many earlier scholars, but what was actually happening to the city was quite miserable. The city was abandoned in the last quarter of the 16th century, and after that it was completely, systematically destructed by for several centuries as well, particularly from 17th, 18th century. So naturally we had a problem with tracing the urban pattern of these cities of medieval period of Bengal, which is actually, we term it as a capital, twin capital city, because different, this capital of the Sultanate Bengal, it was shifted like a pendulum from time to time. The first Muslim invasion was taken place in 1205, around 1205. That Lucknowti it was the capital or the seat of the governors of Bengal who ruled under the instruction of the Delhi Sultanate, Delhi Sultans from time to time, and it continued for around a period of 125 years or so. So more or less from 1340s, during that time, Bengal actually became independent. And from that period point of time, the newly established capital city was in the city of, which is presently the city of Pandua in Malda district. And it was, that time it was known as Firozabad, not as Pandua. It was known as Firozabad and based on the two rivers, that was Mohananda and Kalindi. And after, and the capital in Firozabad that continued till around 1450 or so. We do not have exact date of this kind of transfer of the capital or any other event took place during this time. That is the main problem that we undertook this project. It suffers from lack of contemporary documents, written documents. So we do not have any kind of contemporary documents, so we do not have any specific date apart from Minhaj-I-Siraj, Tabakat-e-Nasiri composed by Minhaj-I-Siraj. Very few incidents have been mentioned there. So that was actually the problem that we are trying to focus upon, and that's why the Directorate of Archaeology and Islamic History Department of Calcutta University, they started to explore these two cities, the twin capital cities, Gaur and Pandua, to trace out the urban pattern. And for this work, we have no option other than to explore the entire city. And before exploration, we had to make a very thorough documentation of whatever documents, maps, etc. is available from the archives, from the collected district collectorates, and also from the near contemporary documents or the source material that we have used. And mostly coins as well as inscription, that also played a very important role, which has helped us a lot in getting the city or the establishment of the capital or the shifting of the capital from Pandua to Gaur and again to Pandua, things like that. So in 1992, when we started our project, it was a collaborative work, and a team worked with was Professor Anirudh Rai, Professor Kamaruddin, and Professor Ratnabali Chatterjee from Islamic History and Culture Department, Calcutta University, and Dr. Gautam Shengupta, Mr. Pratik Kumar Mitra from Directorate of Archaeology, and me as a research scholar. And as a homework, we did a map, which was an 18th century map prepared by J.J.Pemberton, and that was actually acted as the base map for our entire project. And on the basis of that, we have started exploration. Shall I mention a little about the methodology that we have worked upon?
Sure.
So that will, I mean, it is a vast city. If we talk about Gaur, it is a vast city of almost 50 square kilometers. So no arbitrary planning and arbitrary work can be done. So we had to make a kind of sector division of the entire city. So for Gaur, we have made a kind of 15 hypothetical, we have divided it into 15 hypothetical sectors. And so for our knowledge goes, we kind of conducted a proper archaeological exploration work with the map. And whenever we have went to the sites, we have tried to plot those sites into the topographical sheet and also in the basic map that I have already mentioned. And gradually, over a period of 5 years' time, we could locate at least 113 sites in the entire city. And on the basis of the category of the material or the material culture that we have found from this from these explorations which we have carried out in these cities, we have divided the entire city in six urban zones. As the primary focus of the city was to trace out the urban pattern, so we have first traced, I mean, we have made it very clear that we can divide the entire city in different urban zones. And that was how we have done our exploration. But unfortunately, we couldn't do any excavation as we didn't get the permission from Archaeological Survey of India. But later on, in 2005 or so, Archaeological Survey of India themselves, they conducted a limited area excavation in the particular palace area of the capital city. And within this enclosure, the royal center, there are monuments. I mean, there is two monuments, especially two famous monuments are there. And apart from that, there is a huge wall. Only the wall is standing, which is not known, popularly known as Bhaiskoji wall, that is 66 feet tall high wall. That is actually the outer boundary wall of the palace. And within that wall, the actual palace was there, which does not exist today. Whatever we find today is only the compartmental division, the traces of the compartmental divisions of the palace, and thereby we got that there were at least three compartmental divisions in the palace. And as per or on the basis of the category of the findings that you have mentioned, or as we say in an archaeological term, the material culture, we could divide it into three compartments. The first one is the administrative quarter, that is the Darbar Hall. The second one is the Khash Mahal, the living part of the sultans. And the third one is the Janana Mahal, where the women folk of the palace used to live. So these are the three compartments. The basic material, primary findings of this area is ceramics of different quality. Firstly, we can say that which are the very ordinary ceramics that we call coarseware. And another category is Chinese porcelain, I mean the deluxe ware. And another thing with that we have found it's very exclusive, that is also bathware. And celadon. Celadon is one variety of Chinese porcelain. These are the ceramics or the utensils or the tableware that we are talking about. Then so far as the architectural fragments or the building material is concerned, that we have found from gold from different parts and especially from this palace area, those are the glazed tiles and glazed bricks. Tiles have been used, obviously you can understand, in the walls of the monuments, and glazed floors, glazed tiles which have been used to decorate the floors. Even we have found a kind of half circular pipes, which are, we rather like to say it's not the pipes, it's a roof tile, half circular glazed roof tiles, which could have been used to decorate the sloping or the inclined roof of the buildings. So these are the things that we have found. Apart from terracotta sling balls, glass bangles, and very small pieces of tiny little miniature bottle could be. So these are the things that we have found, and we have found one more very commonly found thing, that is cord. So basically these are the things that we have found, and apart from that you can say, apart from glazed bricks, we have found number of plain terracotta bricks which are decorated but not glazed. So we have found plain number of porcelain shards, and we have checked the quality. These are actually very classic tradeware of China, which must have been used by the royal people and the noble people of the Sultanate period. And we have referenced that Bengal had a regular trade connection with China during the beginning of 15th century to middle of 15th century. But when we find it in Gaur, Gaur itself started from 1457 or from the middle of 15th century. That means China had a regular trade connection, if not royal trade, but the private trade connection with Gaur. And that's why we have found number of Chinese porcelain, which are, some of them are very fine quality, very fine thin pieces. Some of those are of course bit crude, bit coarse in character. And another thing, apart from porcelain, we have found celadonware, which looks like kind of the color of the ware is like olive green color. Later on, the scholars during the Mughal period, the Badshahs used to use as a poison detector ware. So that is a very typical thing, but we have found it from the Sultanate phase. And also I should mention, we have found some of the number of shards, porcelain shards, which are with inscription. That's earlier scholars used to say these are Proto-Bengal inscriptions, and all these inscriptions, designs, everything are underglazed. That is the one thing I should mention. These are not overglazed. That means the inscription have been done earlier, and after that the glaze has been put on it. But nowadays, I've started to work on porcelain in depth, and I found that these are not actually Proto-Bengal script. These are the Tibetan Lanchester, which the Chinese potters, they used to do it for different. One word is repeating on the shards, so it doesn't make any complete word or complete sentence. These are some small little letters, which is well-wishing or something like that. So these are the very fascinating findings, and I think from Eastern India, this type of finding is very rare and very important. And the most important word that I have missed, that all these wares are belong to the Ming period of China. You might have known that it's a very long dynasty. Duration of the dynasty was very long. But whatever we have found, it generally starts from, I have checked with the experts, it starts from 1480 to latest to 1525, which finally fits into the fits with the period of our later Shia dynasty and the Hussein Shia dynasty. The two monuments which I meant to say, one is Kadam Rasul, which is a religious structure, and where the feet of Rasul is it's kept there, and one custodian is there who is called Khadim. This is a very typical, the architecture is very typical of the Sultanate architecture of Bengal, with all kind of regional characteristics which have been incorporated, very nicely decorated with terracotta work. And the other one is very interesting, that is called Chika. We say it's a Chika monument because till date the nature of the structure is not determined, but all kind of evidence goes for a hypothesis that it is a Chika mausoleum. Firstly, because of the type of the architecture, it is a single dome architecture with a carved cornice on the four sides, which very similar to the Eklaki monument, which is in Pandua. In fact, we think that the Eklaki monument in Pandua was built by Jalaluddin Muhammad Shah, the last ruler who ruled from Firozabad as a capital. And after that, the capital shifted to Gaur. So there is a strong possibility, and apart from that, I mean, around this building, we have found not only, I should not say we, that a very long back Archaeological Survey of India, during the time of Cunningham, Alexander Cunningham, they have started a small amount of excavation. In fact, we did not discuss about the prior excavations and explorations done by many other people, not always in a systematic way, but they have done quite important works. So that time they have found things like the graviers. And till date, it's somehow or the other, you can peep into that kind of graviers, which are hollow inside. And this building, it's very so similar to the Eklaki mausoleum in nature, and could be the cenotaph or the maqbara of the deceased person, or could be a mausoleum of a dynasty. So it could be the case that there was not only one cenotaph or one tombstone. There could be several tombstones within this building. But so far as our evidences goes, we think this is a mausoleum which could be of the later Ilyashi dynasty, who founded actually the capital, this capital city, which were situated in the present day. So since the architectural pattern and other evidences says that this could be, this Chika mausoleum could be, or the area around Chika mausoleum could be the graveyard or the cemetery of the first dynasty of Gaur, that is the later Ilyashian dynasty, so we have termed it, or we have plotted it as cemetery A. But so far as the cemetery B is concerned, we do not have any monument which exists there. But we have the ruins of the monuments. And probably you know that Henry Creighton, who was an indigo planter in 18th century, who did a very nice survey during that period. It was very difficult for him, and he had to cross a lot of obstacles to make a very good survey of that ruins. In fact, he did, prepared a very good scientific map of the ruins of Gaur. So he, and within his report, he made 18 paintings of different monuments which were standing in the Gaur. And one of those was Hussein Shah's tomb, that he described, and he gave a very nice photograph, I mean, I should not say photograph, the painting of the monument, which is decorated with blue and white tiles. And he has given some kind of description, some kind of distance from certain point of time, which exists till then. And when we went to the field and we took the measurement, and we found that there are architectural ruins of architectural material, like the base of the pillars, like the different that kind of blue and white tiles, which are scattered here and there. And it is a bit high mound, which is above the level of the other surface. And there, after a small clearing by our team, we found that a tombstone, a pillar, and remains of several pillars, everything is there, and the area is almost, it's very, almost in a square shape, and which fits the plan of the of a mausoleum. It could be another the place of the mausoleum. And since we do not have the permission for digging, so we could not dig out any grave or tombstone from there, but the cenotaph, which actually covers the maqbara or the deceased body, that we have found from that area. So a lot of archaeological evidences are there, and that's why we have termed it or located it as a cemetery B, which perhaps the cemetery of the Hussein Shahi period, Sultans of the Hussein Shahi period. the main support system of the entire city, the people who used to cater the city or the to help the to run the business of the city day to day purposes, those people used to live in that quarter, and perhaps that is the area where before establishing or before building the palace of the, at the royal center and the citadel area, perhaps that was the first dwelling area of the sultans, because the main attraction of this urban core, a huge area has been demarcated by us as urban core, as we have found the material which could be very good archaeological evidences to say so. And the main attraction of the area is Gulmant. There is a mosque, huge mosque, that is called Gulmant Mosque. And why we presume that this is the earliest area where the Sultan probably first had a temporary dwelling could be, because this Gulmant Mosque, it is a small replica of the Adina Mosque of Pandua. Because the plan of the ground plan of the mosque, it matches absolutely, I mean it's the same as Adina Masjid in Pandua, but of course not as big as Adina. And this is the perhaps the most neglected monument till date in among the ruins or among the other monuments of Gaur today. Very few people used to go there, and thereby the entire area which was surrounding this Gulmant Mosque, we find some of the pre-Islamic materials as well. So that was probably the habitation area of the people who used to live before the sultans came here to build their own capital. And so much so that we have found a kind of, we have found number of pillars which are presently kept in the local school, where you can find inscription in Siddha Matrika script. And we have found one's name as Jokhopal, Jokhopalosho Bihar. So that was the area the pre-Islamic settlement were there, that Chotoshagor Dighe is there, stayed there, and on the north side of Chotoshagor Dighe, there is a huge mound, huge, I mentioned huge, and it, the entire mound is filled up with the remains of the building. Huge pillars, which itself suggests that it was a, there was a massive building, and some of the pillars which are also decorated with pre-Islamic motifs or the figures of the earlier monuments could be. I mean that happened actually in many places. The earlier pre-Islamic building material have been reused in Islamic buildings. So those are there, and look, the mound is locally known as Chandshodagore Pita, which is of course related with some kind of legend, the local legends. But actually we have a kind of some information, and a small scale, very small scale excavation was done earlier by Archaeological Survey of India. They could not come into any conclusion because that was a very small trench digging, not a full-fledged excavation. And we could, we had a feeling, and we had assumed from other evidences as well, that it could be the Belbari Madrasa, because there was a madrasa in this city of Gaur. On the other part of the Gaur, the southern suburb, which is nowadays in Bangladesh part, the Archaeological Department of Bangladesh, after independence of course, they have unearthed a huge madrasa called Doraswari Madrasa. And so far as the area of the entire area of the madrasa is concerned, the pattern is concerned, it very very similar, it very much matches with this one that we have found in this place. So it could be the Doraswari Madrasa, and it is linked with the main thoroughfare by a paved road. There are so many things, I mean we do not discuss about other things which are part and parcel of an urban area. The entire area is connected by bridges, because there is a man-made canal which was actually the navigation of between the two cities, and there were a lot of bridges, number of bridges which used to cater, even one of the bridges excavator to the till date the main highway which connects India and Bangladesh, that is called Firozpur Road or something like that. It's not national highway. That goes over the bridge which is made of five arch. The inscription that we have found from this place, from nearby these five arch, that is the earliest inscription of Nasiruddin Mahmud Shah, whom we consider as the builder of this capital city of Gaur. So these are the things, and that is the noble, that the speciality of the noble area, that it all it connects to the all or connects to all main thoroughfare and the principal center of the city. And so far as the garrison area is concerned, that we have found in the northern part of the city, there is a mud-built fort wall which is known as Fulbari Fort in the old maps as well, and even today it is known as Fulbari Fort. And we have found number of iron slabs which could be a center of ammunition, arms and ammunition, and some other things, some other material that we have found from that place led us to believe that it could be the garrison area of the city. And not many habitations have been found, but one important evidence that supports our view, that is a mass burial that we have found very nearby, very close to this place, which is the area is known as Ghatatpala, which is very close to this Fulbari Fort. And there we have found three stone cenotaphs or tombstone where the inscription from Quran, the Quranic verses are inscribed, and which says that this was a mass burial. So could be it was, it very much fits the theory that it was a garrison area. And so far as the fringe area is concerned, it is absolutely at the fringe of the city, northern fringe of the city, and the area and the soil of that area is absolutely suitable for cultivation, and till date cultivation is going on. It could be served as a buffer area of the city, because when if anyone attacks the city, then he had to cross at least 10 kilometers before before the troop can enter into the main area. Actually, Borshona Masjid is probably the last monument that was built in this city, capital city. It was built by Nasiruddin Mahmud Shah, the son of Hussein Shah, the great ruler Hussein Shah, Alauddin Hussein Shah. And the name came from that Boroshona means the great golden mosque. And the mosque was built with 12 into 3, yes, 36 domes probably. And all these domes were actually covered with the golden gate. And that's where the name came from, the Boroshona Masjid. It is also known as Barduari Masjid. That means there are 12 doorways, arch doorways, and there are 3 bays, so 12 into 3, 36 domes were there. And this was obviously the Jami Mosque or the Congregational Mosque built by Nasiruddin Nusrat Shah. And we have also discovered, we have published a very rare inscription found from this place, very nearby, quite close to this place. And our team member, Sri Pratik Kumar Mitru, he published this inscription where it says that the erection of the main entrance gateway of the mosque. So generally these people were very history conscious people, and always they used to write or keep the records, and in case of Bengal it was always on stone. So we are lucky in that way that hundreds of stone inscriptions are there. Before this project, before this field work that we have done here, we did not know even about the material culture of the Sultanate period of Bengal. We did not know about we only knew that there were two capital cities, but we did not know how these cities were, how was the urban pattern, how was the urban landscape of the area of these two cities. And as I mentioned, there were twin capital cities. The first interesting feature is that these two cities were entirely bounded by embankment or the rampart wall that we say. And obviously when once a city is bounded by a rampart wall, it has to have a piercing the gateways to enter into the city and to get out of the city. So there were two huge gateways on the northern end as well as on the south end of the city. The northern gateway, it's a complete ruins. We don't have any trace of it. But the southern gate of the city, which is known as Kotwali Darwaza, nowadays basically this is the entry point from Malda to Bangladesh. And the BSF outpost is right on the Kotwali Darwaza. And it's a huge architecture with built within the rampart wall. Apart from that, the entire city was connected or crisscrossed by the main thoroughfares, which are still in use and which are still used by the international trading conveyance. The huge and large number of lorries and trucks, they used to queue up on the streets, on the road, to reach the border of the Bangladesh area. So that is not our motto or the objective of the project. Our objective was to understand the city pattern. So we found that the city was very scientifically built up on the very strategic location, which is higher than any other surrounding areas, but right on the bank of the Ganges. It never flooded by any of the monsoonal rain or any flooding, because it was totally surrounded by the huge rampart walls or embankment, which you may also refer as the causeways. Secondly, we did this exploration work, we could divide the entire city in 6 specific zones. That is very important to understand our urban city of the medieval period, and it also confirms the pattern of the Islamic city formation. That is also very important that we came to know from this project. Thirdly, there was a kind of movement in Indo-Islamic architecture by the Bengal school, and all the typical regional characteristics which were incorporated in the this particular Indo-Islamic architecture of Bengal are very prominently understood by the monuments if we study. As we have only mentioned about the largest one, the Borosona Masjid, we have mentioned about Gunman Mosque, we have mentioned about Kadam Rasul and Chika, but we have left some other very important mosque, namely Latin Mosque, which was a huge, which is a very interesting kind of characteristics, where we find domes along with the chala. Charchala, the typical hut architecture of Bengal, along with the entire building from outside as well as from the inside. It was covered by the glazed bricks. We have missed to mention about Tantipara Mosque, which is also in the urban core of the area. Latin is very nearer to the Royal Nobles Quarter, while Tantipara, and the name you see, the name suggests that Tantipara, which was a weaver's quarter of the city. We don't have any particular information that the weavers used to live in that area, and we don't know how this name came from. But it is a very very nicely done Jami Mosque. This was another Jami Mosque, which never people mentioned in their writing, and we have that evidence. And also, this is one single mosque where in Gaur, where you find the largest amount of terracotta work, very delicate terracotta work that we have seen in Iklaki almost 150 years back. Then you find Champati. There is a very small mosque which says Champati. These names itself signifies that several quarters were there in and around the noble quarter and the royal center, which used to cater the people or the royal people of the city. And I also should mention about Firoz Minar, the only victory tower of the city. Because, you know, as we read a study in the Islamic architecture, Minar or the victory towers, that is one of the main or the important aspect of Indo-Islamic architecture, and Gaur can boast on it having Firoz Minar. So, and after earthquake, for 2 or 3 times it was renovated, but it's still there, and it is fascinating. And one can have an entire view if you go to the top of this minar And Minar is also a very interesting in our character. So we are not going into the detail. Apart from that, we should mention about the thoroughfares that I told you, and also the bridges. And the funny thing is, and interesting also, that when you across the city, if you go across the city, the number of bridges increases. When on the eastern part, number of bridges only one, that means the canal on which the bridge was built was very narrow. And as it gradually progressed towards Ganges to the east, to the west, the Ganges used to flow on the western part of the city. So as it gradually came towards west to meet Ganges, it widens and naturally the number of bridges increases. So we find bridge of one arch, then we find some in distance we find bridge of three arches, which is very close to that Belwadi Madrasa. Then on the highway, that the main thoroughfare, we find the bridge of five arches that I have mentioned. And at the end, which is very near to the Gunman Mosque, which is in the southwestern quarter of the city, we found bridge of seven arches, which is almost in ruins nowadays. So the entire character of a settlement, not only urban pattern, the settlement pattern of the city, which is very important, and settlement archaeology, I mean, that is the most important aspect of archaeological work these days. So that has been, I think that we could do at least something